Hello, everybody, and can you please take your seats? I know we're all rushing about today, and people are coming and going, but we are trying to keep on track. My name is Gillian Tett. I'm with the Financial Times newspaper, and I'm delighted to be kicking off this next session, session number four, which is entitled Delivering Finance for Emerging Market and Developing Economies. Now, just over an hour ago, I was moderating a fascinating discussion where Ayaz Sayed Kayum, who's a Minister of Economy of Fiji, made an impassionate intervention, which frankly should be on the desk of every finance minister in the developed world, where he basically said that the current system for climate finance for developing nations simply does not work. It's uncertain, it's incomplete, it's expensive. It needs to be changed. And since today is Finance Day and we have the money men and women in town, the question going forward is, can people build a finance system for climate transition that's both effective and equitable? Both of those E's matter enormously. So what we're going to be hearing from now in the panel is thoughts from a number of different countries and institutions about what needs to happen next, and what could and what should happen next, rather. So to start, we're going to hear, first of all, from the Chancellor, who is actually about to come, not yet here yet, I believe, who's actually just walked in the door. How's that for a dramatic entrance? The narrative suspense is sky high now. So we're now going to hear from the Chancellor, who's just arrived, probably a little breathless, having run to be here, to tell us his perspective on what could and should be done next in relation to developing and emerging markets finance. The Chancellor, the floor is yours, and I hope you have a chance to catch your breath. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Gillian, and good afternoon, everyone. Developing and emerging markets have been devastated by the double tragedies of coronavirus and climate change. Now, we have to make sure that the wall of capital we are building is there for economies that need it most. And if we're honest with ourselves, there have been years of rhetoric about turning the billions into trillions, and that rhetoric now needs to be matched with reality. The challenge we've got now, thanks to the leadership of many like Mark, is not necessarily the finance. What we need to do now is to match those investments with viable, bankable projects. So my question for this session is simple. What more are you, what more are we going to do to support low-income countries who are trying their absolute best to transition to net zero or adapt to the consequences of climate change? We've got two panels coming up, one on the role of the private sector and the multilateral development banks and development finance institutions, respectively. I was just going to make three very brief points to help frame those discussions. First, we need MDBs to step in to help deliver the promise of $100 billion of finance for developing countries. The MDBs have a good record on this, and the joint statement is a great start. Now, we need full detail on the scale of the ambition to fully meet what developing countries are asking for, dramatically scaling up private finance to be mobilized. Second, country platforms have enormous potential to support the climate transition in developing economies. We've got to reduce the fragmentation we're seeing in the way that global climate finance currently works. These country platforms, centered around what nations tell us they need to implement their ambitious NDCs, will combine public and private finance with technical assistance, bringing enormous benefits from scale and coordination. Third, I'm pleased to say that the UK is making concrete announcements today on improving access to finance. As the Prime Minister just announced, we are providing an India Green Guarantee to the World Bank to directly unlock $1 billion for green projects across India. We're committing £200 million of international climate finance to the LEAF Coalition, a new billion-dollar initiative aiming to catalyse public and private finance to protect forests. And I'm also delighted to announce we're increasing by nearly £70 million our funding for the UK's international climate finance programme, Mobilised, with three new specific initiatives announced today. Together, these projects will help developing countries access new markets, create new green jobs, and grow their economic resilience. But I'll stop there and hand back over to, I think, our two brilliant panel chairs. Julian, is that right? Or am I handing back over to you? But so I'll hand over to you and to Mark and Minister Arbeleche to thank them for all they do. And again, thank you for all you do. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Chancellor. I should say it's standing room only now, which indicates the importance of this event. We're now going to hear from the Finance Minister of Indonesia, Sri Mulyani Indrawati, who's in a very interesting position because not only is Indonesia something of a petri dish for experimentation around a number of climate finance issues to do with, say, carbon pricing or blended finance, but also the minister has been at the center of the Bretton Woods establishment and the Washington debates in recent years, and so is in a position to offer a very important perspective in terms of what now needs to happen in channeling money to emerging markets and developing economies. The minister.
Thank you so much, Gillian. It's really an honor for me to open this very important meeting. Ladies and gentlemen, we are actually now in a very critical situation, which all leaders has already make a pledge about how we are going to deliver the net zero emission, as well as our Paris Agreement. Indonesia, in this case, has already creating a lot of commitment, which is announced to the public. Here, we've already made, for example, for our NDC, which is being upgraded, in which we are putting not to build a new coal power plant. Remember that Indonesia is a big producer of coal, and we are still having huge also within our energy mix. So this kind of commitment with a very clear time path is very, very critical for Indonesia. And so the question is not about commitment, how we are going to be able to deliver that commitment. And within that context, financing is very, very critical. That's why this morning we discussed and we announced with the ADB to announce the energy transition mechanism. So this is the second issue that Rishi Sunak mentioned about the role of MDB. They are coming to provide us with the platform how a country like Indonesia, who show a commitment and have a clarity on a timeline, can deliver that promise. This is going to be a platform in which we are going to be able to first structure how we are going to retire coal earlier. That means we are going to buy the contract with the real money and have another funding to build the compensation that is renewable energy to replace the coal as well as to support the new demand on energy. This is critical. So this kind of platform is going to be very critical for institutions like the MDB to also answer those kind of question. On a country partnership or platform, I think this is also the approach which is already being adopted by Multilateral Development Bank. I know that ADB, World Bank, they all have country partnership program. So if we are going to focus on a dedicated climate change, this can be expanded from that kind of partnership program, in which we are going to identify what will it take for a country to deliver a national determined contribution or even net zero emission, which is going to certainly cost the country significantly. Each country have their own responsibility. In this case, the NDC should be translated, and in this case also, they need to have a clear, coherent, transparent, and credible plan, which is not only including the estimated financing need, but also how we are going to get those financing need. I will give you the example of Indonesia. 270 billion will be required to finance the NDC by 2030. 21% coming from our budget, that is public money. Some it will be coming from the existing private sector, but we identify around 50% is still a financing gap. So the question about the financing gap, in which financial sector now pledge 133 trillion available globally, how you are going to link with maybe just 270 billion, 50% of it, which is not too big comparing to 130 trillion. So this is really a discussion, very detailed, regarding what kind of financial structure that is available there, how we are going to invite them, what kind of risk appetite from the financial sector, what kind of prudential and financial regulation that will then improving the ability and the appetite of financial system to be able to come to emerging and developing country. And for developing country and emerging country, take example of Indonesia. I mentioned this morning about that we already diversify instrument. For example, we introduce carbon tax. We also issue green bond domestically at the retail side as well as globally. But the premium is not really providing this green instrument in a favorable interest. So market definitely not yet work properly to put the green as a bonus or premium, so that the developing and emerging country, I'm sure many of them will start now issuing green bonds. You are going to pay still the same price as your conventional bond. This is not acceptable. We also creating de-risking instrument within Indonesia. We also put blended finance. So we are providing quite a lot of both instrument, institutional setting and policy in order for us to be able to bridge the gap between private sector pooling fund, which is 100 trillion more, with the appetite that will fit with the country platform. And this is exactly maybe the most important key deliverable that need to be discussed during the G20 meeting, in which Indonesia is going to chair or the presidency. And it is also linking to the ability for 100 billion pledged by advanced country, which is not yet there, and also 130 trillion private financial institution money, which is sitting there. So this is going to be one of the most concrete discussion. So I do hope that Indonesia can become one of the example, which we do our homework, we are committed, we deliver. We also, in this case, passing the legislation on a carbon market and carbon price, as well as carbon tax. So a set of all necessary condition is there. My question to you, what is the sufficient condition to deliver the real money to deliver this commitment? So I do hope that we are all together here in this afternoon in Glasgow, COP26, and I really also congratulate the United Kingdom for hosting this very important meeting and all the initiative which the UK government has already launched. We do hope that this meeting is going to become a kickstart for the real credible financing for our commitment to net zero emission. We are going to save the world if we can work out on the financing side. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Sri Mulyani, for delivering a tough message
with such charm and clarity. And let's hope that everyone now listens. We're going to have now a panel, which is going to be moderated by Mark Carney, who is the UN Special Envoy on Climate Action and Finance, together with Shimara Wickramanayake, who's CEO of Macquarie, John Johnson, who's CEO of PKA, Mahin Rahman, who's CEO of Infra Zamin, Leila Fouri, who's CEO of Johannesburg Stock Exchange, and Cristiano Teixeira, who's CEO of Kleibin. So I'd like to invite you all to come up to the stage, and I look forward to what should be a very interesting debate. Over to you, Mark.
That's promising.
Okay, fantastic, and thank you all for making the time. It is time well spent because there couldn't be a more important issue, at least in my opinion, in terms on Finance Day, which is, you know, we've established a couple of things. Many of you knew the first one, which is just the absolute scale of investment that's needed globally in order for the transition to happen to get to net zero by 2050, consistent with 1.5 degrees. Over $100 trillion globally, but then what it means for emerging and developing economies, an additional, on most estimates, additional $1 trillion a year of flows by at least the middle of this decade on an annual basis, year in, year out, and then scaling from there. We do well to remember those orders of magnitude in these discussions because we're looking for vehicles and approaches that can scale rapidly. Sustainably. If they start as pilots, they have to move up. The challenge that Sri Mulyani has set us, which is right, and I think it's very good to stay focused on this, which is how does the 130 translate to the 200, and I think we've rounded it up to 270. Let's maybe 270, 280 billion that's required for the Indonesian transition. You know, the element of an approach, I'm going to say a couple of remarks and then get straight into the questions. And the Chancellor touched on it. Others have touched on it. Sri Mulyani touched on it, which is an enhanced country platform approach. So at the essence of this, and this is easier said than done, and there's been impressive progress on this, and I commend as well the NDB statement of yesterday, is to have coordination amongst the various flows of official finance. And including on technical assistance. But that needs to be twinned across or combined across the entire capital stack, if you will. So blended finance vehicles, the spinach of international finance, as our moderator, Gillian, had said in the morning, but blended finance at scale, and blended finance that gets multiples of public capital as opposed to, in terms of the private flows, as opposed to fractions. Bankable projects maybe I'll just say in terms of those options on blended finance that we are seeing vehicles now. There are some existing vehicles of the EBRD, vehicles of the World Bank, such as the IFC specifically, the MCPP, but new private and philanthropic innovation around blended finance, the Climate Innovation Fund, the Asian Development Bank involved in that, as well as some private players, the Rockefeller Foundation's announcement of yesterday, I guess, the BlackRock announcement of overnight, where you see concessional capital bringing substantial multiples and building on that, including, and I think this is a challenge to the system, including on sovereign risk, broader sovereign risk and foreign exchange risk if we're going to get the scale that we can. Very importantly, catalytic initiatives from the private sector that bring into place the type of projects that are not just bankable but can be scaled and think, and we have the experts on the table, the CFLI approach, pilots in India and Indonesia, fast infrastructure being two examples. And then I would add to that, there is tremendous value in a world where the core of the financial system, a very, very large core of the financial system, is looking for net zero aligned assets in having validation of what is net zero aligned in countries. And it is different in different countries, at different stages of development, different challenges that they face. And there needs to be objective measures for that, so that if you picture it, the $130 trillion of capital that's looking now, can argue it should have been looking before, but it's absolutely resolutely focused on looking for those net zero aligned assets in around the world to have the confidence that it's taking those steps. And there's certainly a role for the multilateral development banks to play in that, in some of our judgment. Okay, enough from me. So we have a very distinguished panel, and they have been introduced at the high level, and so I am now going to turn to them, starting with you, Shamara, obviously CEO of Macquarie, leading a key work stream in GFANZ on precisely this issue, working with a series of governments and others. And really, I'm going to ask you just to, can you describe, tell us what you're doing, Shamara, about this issue, because in many respects, if I may, the task has been set for Shamara to help solve these issues.
Well, thank you, Mark, and to GFANZ and CFLI for supporting us in addressing this important task. And I guess in terms of what we're doing to mobilise capital for developing countries, I wanted to start by acknowledging that developing countries have actually been getting quite a bit done. So Brazil and Chile, for example, were the first countries to run meaningful clean energy auctions. And it was in Brazil that the cost of onshore wind came down to below $50 for the first time. And those auctions also catalyzed what happened in the UK and Taiwan. And India, in terms of solar, has committed now, I think Prime Minister Modi lifted it from 450 to 500 gigawatts, and it was bringing down the cost of solar that allowed that to happen. Now, having said that, we still need to accelerate what's going on tremendously if we're going to deliver what's needed for these developing economies and the global community. And I'd start by noting that there's still 800 million people without access to energy, and many others that have to be really sensitive to the cost of energy and curtail their needs if the costs are going up too much. So we need to deliver energy to help these countries urbanize and industrialize and lift living standards of their citizens to where developed countries are. But we need that to do that in a way where we're minimizing carbon emissions, because if they do it with the same carbon intensity that they've done for the last two decades, or we all have, they're going to eat up half the carbon budget that we have out to 2050. So that's going to require a tremendous amount of investment. And as Mark said, that's $1 trillion a year that we're going to need out of that $130 trillion that we have across all the emerging economies, not just, and developing countries, not just Indonesia. But at the moment, what we've got is, for every dollar invested in the emerging economies, in this $20 gets invested in the developed economies. And so even though we have $130 trillion, the challenge is de-risking the investment opportunity in the developing countries so that that capital can flow. And as an intermediary of that capital through our balance sheet, or as an asset manager using fiduciary money, we know that we have to deliver reasonable returns relative to the risk for the people, the custodians of that money, the savers and the pensioners and retirees of the world. So what we're trying to do, Mark, to answer your question, is to try and create frameworks that do help de-risk the investment opportunity, helping these countries lift their living standards in a low carbon emission way. And there are three big things we're doing. So as people have referred to, we thought we would start with country platforms, because the glide path has to be tailored to each individual country. And if we can get some pilots going where the framework works, we can roll it out to others. So we're looking at the moment, the Climate Finance Leadership Initiative that Michael Bloomberg is running is focusing on India and Indonesia as the leading countries that we're going to try and roll this out with and then take it to others. What we need to do there is create frameworks where developing market governments, together with developed market governments, MDBs, and the private sector, put together structures where this money can flow in a way that people see a long-term glide path and the security in bringing the capital in a meaningful way. So the country pilots are the first one, and that's frameworks, identification of priority sectors, putting in pipelines of projects, working with the private sector and the MDB to de-risk MDBs, to de-risk this. And then, you know, the big pipeline of projects is what's important. Secondly, the MDBs, we want to work with the MDBs, and we're still having conversations to understand from them how they see this can be delivered. But we all need to support the MDBs in bringing the finance to de-risk the early money so that we can catalyse that huge amount of 130 trillion of private sector money with the much more limited funding that the governments and the MDBs have. And the third thing you mentioned, Mark, is these catalytic initiatives. So we've sifted through 70 of them and found five we want to prioritise to try and support together with the country platforms. So that's probably enough with me from me on what we're doing. It's still early stage. We've got a long journey. We'd really appreciate the collaboration with people in this room because it is going to, you know, take a village if we're going to get this done.
That's great. Thank you, Shamara. I'll just underscore that last point. Having done the hard work of going through the 70 plus, I think, initiatives, because there's various well-meaning initiatives, but focusing in on the ones you think are going to have the biggest impact as part of what slots in to the approach. John, I'm due to turn to you next, and obviously PKA has had a tremendous experience in this area, including in Africa. And I wonder, you know, help us out, draw some lessons from that experience and in meeting the Sri Mulyani challenge.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you, Shamira, for your great work and the GFANS team and the emerging market track of that work. It is true, Mark, that PKA has been working in this area for actually many years, and we've been into the green the green transformation for more than a decade, and now we have invested 10% of our asset base in the green transformation and are aiming for a further 15% or up to 15% by 2025. So it's an integrated part of us doing business. We also have some investments in emerging market and developed economies. It is something that we have been working on for a while. And from our perspective, it's down to a very simple relationship, as always when doing investments, between return and risk. And we do not always understand the risk related to doing these type of investments in these type of countries. So we need to work together with others, and what we do is that we have for years been working together with the Danish SDG Fund, and we have done collateral investments together, so we're invested together. And what happens is that the Danish government takes some of the initial risk, and we can scale the investment by putting in our funds. And it's been very successful. For one, just as an example, we have invested in a wind farm in Kenya. It produces 15% of the Kenya electricity demand, and it has lowered cost of electricity in Kenya. So it's an actual project. It's the largest wind farm in Africa, and it's a real example of what you can do if you work together. So my main input here would be that we have to work together, and we have to find actual projects and do it and try it out. This project, the one in Lake Turkana, is actually a very well-producing project. It's low risk for us, and it has a fine and fair return that we can, you know, look our members in their eyes. They are nurses, physiotherapists, bioanalytics, and so on, and they will still get a very good pension from an investment like that, and that's very important because we have to do that. That's our fiduciary role. So it's all about working together, and I'm very happy to be part of this in the GFANS, because I think that we can showcase to each other how to actually do this. So thank you.
John, I'm just going to take the opportunity for just one follow-up question on that. So you find this project, it sounds very exciting, it's in a healthy environment in Kenya. Do you do screening on a macro risk or a sovereign risk or a foreign exchange risk where there's certain, and I'm not asking you to name them, but jurisdictions where your time is better spent elsewhere, because after all, as you know, we have to solve this issue everywhere. And I think one of the questions is, in those cases, could you use some support that I presume that the example you're giving in the case in Kenya is outright project risk, but are there other cases where you would look?
yes, we could for sure do with the input and working together. And that's also why I think it's very important what we're doing right now, that the big international financial institutions work together and try to set up sort of a standard and a way of looking at things. It's very important for us, and it would be a great help for us. And then we also have set up, this is not something that PKA does it in itself. We have set up a separate company together with the Danish government, and they are specialized in assessing the risk related to these type of investments. And all input on how to do that in the best way is something that will be of great importance to us.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Maheen, I'm going to turn to you, and you know, you've got a great perspective on this. You know, you're catalyzing infrastructure development, focused on Pakistan, not exclusively, but focused on Pakistan, bringing institutional investors in, including domestic pools of capital. So can we have, and I'll just make this observation, that sometimes almost too much focus is on bringing in external capital. Obviously, we need to scale it up, but the blending of the two and your perspective would be very helpful. Thanks.
So Pakistan is one of the most vulnerable countries when it comes to climate change. So there is a very real stake that we have in ensuring climate finance gets to the right projects. Now, Pakistan has actually developed some good policies with regards to financing green projects, in particular towards renewables, towards electric vehicle use, and all of that is coming through concessional financing, which is available actually today and has been available for the last few years. I think the issue that we have faced is that the local lending markets and the local capital markets have yet to determine how to price that risk effectively and how to fund that risk in such a way that it is sustainable not only for the project, but also provides continuous capital to such projects in the future. And I think it's that element of that trigger that we need in the markets today to push financing from the domestic pool towards such climate action projects. And this is where you have blended finance, and this is where you have companies like InfraZamin come in, because we look at the debt side, we look at the equity side, and we look at credit enhancement facilities that can actually de-risk a project and make it viable and bankable and bring that to the local capital community. Now, the very interesting thing about projects such as InfraZamin is that they are incredibly scalable. For every $50 that is invested by InfraZamin, we can release up to $500 million into the local market. And that is the aim that we plan to do in Pakistan over the next 3 to 5 years or so. And that in itself, that $500 million, can actually mobilize billions in the form of private sector capital, simply because the comfort factor is built in and the guarantee structures are there to provide that comfort towards such new technologies. And I think what we have seen consistently is that every time there's a technology shift, such as what happened in telecom, say, about 20 years ago, we're again at the element of that shift, where we are looking at new technologies in solar, new technologies on the electric vehicle side, the carbon emission side. And it takes time for the markets to price that risk. But we can trigger that through enhancement structures that allow that risk then to be better understood and in the future be priced without the need for credit enhancement. And that's certainly the aim that we are trying to achieve today. I think, you know, beyond that, it's also important to focus on the supply of projects. And for that, while, you know, Pakistan recognizes its vulnerabilities, ultimately, the supply is ensured if it's conducive to do so. And that can only happen in stable macroeconomic conditions where it makes sense to put forward investment. So it is the responsibility of all of us to consider how to generate those kind of environments that are conducive towards investing in emerging markets, particularly in Pakistan. We must have conversations about debt relief, because it is impossible to talk about delivering more on that front for any country without creating the fiscal space to do so. We must talk about technology transfers that will enable pricing to become cheaper, that will enable financing to be easier for such projects. And finally, when we bring in domestic capital pools, and we do so by de-risking the investments around them, we must also consider how the international community is going to support vulnerable countries like Pakistan through that $100 billion commitment with a coherent plan towards adaptation and mitigation strategies as well.
Fantastic. There's a lot there which, if we have time, and I'm not quite sure how much time we have, but I do know we have the U.S. Treasury Secretary here, so we will keep to time. With a few to come back on, but excellent. Leila, you know, from your perspective, I mean, you do so much in this area, not just with the Johannesburg Stock Exchange, but as co-chair of the Global Investors Sustainable Development Alliance, which is one of really the first alliances to bring together all aspects of finance, focus on this issue, and also leading on sustainable stock exchanges. So, you know, in those various roles, how are you, you know, doing the proverbial mobilizing, you know, turning billions into trillions, and what do you think is going to be most effective?
Mark, it's no coincidence that the country of my birth is possibly a great poster child for the effectiveness and the importance in testing financing towards developing countries. The country of my birth, South Africa, relies on 88% of our power generation is dependent on coal. 25% of that goes to exports, and for every worker in the coal industry, they're supporting at least 3 but up to 10 dependents. And so you can see that we have a very complex social and environmental problem, and the problems that we experience in South Africa, which are exacerbated, by the way, by inequality and having, unfortunately, the highest Gini coefficient in the world, mean that we have to think in a very diverse and balanced way in balancing both the climate and the social dynamics. And so the three key themes that keep coming up in all the work that I've been doing, both at the exchange, at the sustainable stock exchanges, as well as the GISD, is scalability, urgency, and risk sharing. It's a complex problem, and it requires multifaceted interventions. There are three areas that we're focusing on. First, on using our convening influence. Secondly, on products and services. And thirdly, in enabling governance. I'll start with the stock exchange. And we work very closely with the government, and we are delighted to hear of the announcement yesterday, a first of its kind and hopefully not the last, where a historic package was granted to South Africa of $8.5 billion to enable a transition. The Esther Sloan said this afternoon earlier that the first money is often the hardest money to raise. And like Pakistan, what we need to do is we need to enable consistent raising of capital and not just a once-off raising of capital. So insofar as products go, at the exchange level, we've introduced a number of very important and groundbreaking projects relating to green, social, and sustainable bonds. These are up to 3 and 4 times oversubscribed. We are also about to launch a transition bond, which will enable those coal intensive organizations to avoid stranded assets and to avoid a hard stop in finance and have a smoother glide path to transitioning to a net zero. From a governance perspective, we've introduced a number of gender and general ESG-related requirements in our listings requirements, and we have just announced this morning a guidance note on both climate-related disclosures as well as ESG disclosures. And so we're very excited about that. On the global stage, I co-chair the Sustainable Stock Exchanges Initiative with the group CEO of the LSE and work very closely with Mark, and also co-chair the GISD. The GISD is a group of 30 top CEOs focused very much on using their convening power and driving financing, particularly with a focus on developing markets, but ultimately to enable climate financing. From a product perspective, the GISD has had a very busy year. We've delivered an SDG investor platform, which really brings together those who need financing with those who are able to finance. We today launched a net zero climate ETF. This will be launching on the New York Stock Exchange, and we hope to list it on the JSE in time to come. From a governance perspective, one of the biggest problems is the fragmentation of standards around disclosure. And so we've introduced an ESG definition, we've introduced sector-specific measures, and we are working with multilateral bodies to bring in a unified disclosure standard. And so there is much to be done, but I personally am very grateful for my colleagues and for the Secretary General's support at the GISD, as well as Mark Carney's support at the Sustainable Stock Exchanges.
Yeah, there's a shortage, microphone shortage on this panel, but that's good. Cristiano, one of the leading companies in Latin America, certainly in Brazil. You've got immense experience with scaling sustainable investment. On one level, you're a highly successful manufacturer, hugely innovative, but I'm still going to ask you, what additional support would you need, or what do you see in how you operate that addresses these issues?
Thank you, Mark. I think I have to use that opportunity to not only bring the what else we can do for Klabin, for big companies in Brazil or in the whole world, but I think highlight the medium-sized and small companies nowadays. Like you said, in this, let's say, real economy, we have to remember that this is a very historic moment for the climate. We are here and we are going to be in the history of what we did together. But we also are just getting out of this pandemic crisis. We have to remember that the inflation is killing small and medium suppliers all over the world. So the all supply chains are suffering. And this situation, it's kind of getting worse with the logistic crisis. Sorry to bring this day by day situation, but I think it's we have to highlight that in the middle of everything, we have to hear a customer, I guess the price that I needed to raise, because we have to recover margins, we have to face every day to our investor, but we also have these suppliers without a way to finance themselves. And now, bringing back to climate, how are they going to finance, or how the bankers will price their risk? Because they are small and medium-sized suppliers in the developing countries, emerging countries. This is very difficult. I don't see directly solution for those kind of suppliers on the supply chain in the middle of this completely perfect storm. How are they going to do the mitigation and adaptation to change from coal or oil or natural gas to biomass? We big companies, like Klabin, for example, we do pulp and paper for package. And we do package made with a very, aligned product with the megatrends, because it's a biodegradable product. So we have Dow Jones Index, we have all kinds of certifications. So we have no problem to access any kind of funding that we need, any kind, from equity to debit. But what about this small suppliers, medium suppliers, and the self-entrepreneurs? For that, I really would like to highlight that bankers and Asian development agents or development banks needs to be more creative.
Fantastic. Thank you. And it unfortunately draws, I think my responsibility is to draw this to a close, so we can move to hear from Janet Yellen in the next panel. But I'll just emphasize two points, if I may. I mean, we've talked about some of the aspects of the platform approach and how things can fit in. I think the urgency of the work is clear. Something that Leila Mahin Shamara emphasized, the role of the first money in catalyzing the next money. You get it right the first time, and you can really build on that. And it's easy to underestimate how important that is, and given the global nature of the issue, how important it is that we scale rapidly elsewhere. And then, if I may, just picking up, Christiana, on your point, which is a common theme in terms of integration. So integration in terms of thinking not just about the large companies, the large projects, but all the way back through into small, medium-sized enterprises. And you're right. I mean, you're absolutely right to put the issue on the table. Yes, it happens to be. It's a more volatile inflation macroeconomic environment at the moment. But for these projects over the lifetime, there's always going to be periods where it's going to be more volatile and difficult. So we have to have financing structures and support that's consistent all the way through the macroeconomic cycle in countries. The second thing in integration, integrating local investors, Mahin, your emphasis, and John as well. And then fundamentally, Leila and Shamar, I think everyone did, but Leila particularly, on the just transition, that these are not projects in isolation. These are big changes that are happening in all economies. There's displacement in economies, and it needs to be integrated, which is last point, which is why a broader country platform type approach is necessary, because it needs to be integrated with the broader economic policies of the country. And if it is, then it's truly aligned, not just with the transition to net zero, but with the interest of all the citizens. So I thank you very much for what you're doing, for your insights, and I just ask the audience to give our panel a round of applause, and I'll hand over to Jillian. I would now like to introduce the Honorable Janet Yellen, the Treasury Secretary of the United States of America. My apologies for not being present.
Well, thanks to everybody for the chance to speak today. I know some of you, and I've met many colleagues since I've arrived. Because the reality is, it is not common for finance ministers to attend a COP. In fact, I'm the first U.S. Treasury Secretary to do so. The reason I'm here is because climate change is not just an environmental issue. It's not just an energy issue. It is an economic, development, and financial stability issue. And I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't treat it with the seriousness it warrants. Well, this is my first COP. It's not the first time I've jumped into a political discussion on climate change. when I served in the Clinton administration and the team needed a White House official to testify before Congress on the merits of the Kyoto Protocol, I volunteered. I told Congress to think of Kyoto as a form of planetary insurance. Wouldn't even a significant investment in transitioning our economies away from carbon be worth it if it saved entire species and priceless coastal cities, if it helped ensure that we kept the world livable? Well, it's 23 years later, and I think there's more hope than ever before. More and more, we're seeing nations reach across borders to work together toward the common task of keeping the limit of 1.5 degrees global warming within reach. And today, I'd like to spend a few minutes on how the United States is doing its part. President Biden is committed to reasserting U.S. leadership to combat climate change. This spring, he hosted a leaders' summit to ramp up global ambition. We also requested funds to restart our contributions to the Green Climate Fund and other climate funds. In April, the United States announced plans to double our public international climate finance for developing countries by 2024. And then President Biden went to the UN General Assembly and announced we were doubling that number again to $11.4 billion per year. All told, this represents a six-fold increase of financing for adaptation over our previous pledge. But as I spoke about this morning, the amount of funding, that's only one piece. We also have to make sure it's being channeled as quickly and effectively as possible. This includes the Green Climate Fund and the Global Environmental Facility, which play both the critical role of delivering and mobilizing climate finance as operating entities of the UN FCCC and the Paris Agreement. Both funds have been major climate finance providers over the past several years. We want to see continued strong contributions, not only in volume, but in greater efficiency and impact, including exploring how they can better engage the private sector to catalyze more financing for climate efforts. The United States is also calling on the multilateral development banks to increase their efforts. Bringing together the heads of several of these banks over the summer, and then again last month, I urged each institution to develop concrete plans to raise their climate ambition and to identify specific ways they could mobilize more climate finance. While there's still more to be done, I'm pleased with the progress made so far this year. Every government will face difficult choices as it seeks the best pathway to a zero emissions and climate resilient future. And MDBs are well positioned to provide advice and resources to smooth that transition. As part of a smooth transition, it's critical to encourage coal decommissioning in a way that supports impacted communities, including through the Clean Technology Fund's new Accelerating Coal Transition Program. Expediting the transition away from coal by both ending public international funding for new coal projects and providing innovative financing instruments to hasten the closure of existing coal-fired plants, that's perhaps the most immediately impactful policy decision we can make from a climate perspective. This October, the United States reached a consensus at the OECD with our international partners to prohibit export credit financing for unabated coal power. This will effectively eliminate billions of dollars in future international government spending on some of the dirtiest energy sources, freeing up our limited public resources to focus on the investments in technologies that keep us on the path to net zero. But no amount of public financing alone will be sufficient to meet the demands of the climate crisis. Private capital is essential to our success. As we work to mobilize this capital, we must continue to focus on addressing the challenges that emerging markets in developing countries face in attracting private sector financing. We're making progress on improving international coordination, on aligning financial flows with our collective climate goals through the G20 Sustainable Finance Working Group. I was pleased to join my fellow finance ministers to endorse the G20 Sustainable Finance Roadmap, which highlights actions to scale up sustainable finance, including capacity building and technical support to emerging markets and developing countries. Tackling the climate crisis is imperative, and at the same time, it's the greatest economic opportunity of our time. We can and will create good-paying jobs and new industries as we tackle climate change. This holds true not just for the United States, but for all countries. We know the impacts of climate change are being felt now and are falling heavily on the world's most vulnerable. COP26 must be a turning point, the moment when we commit to taking the necessary actions to reach net zero emissions by 2050. Thank you.
Thank you so much for those inspiring words, words that indeed we need to think about in a developed and a developing world context. We would like to welcome up on stage the next panel, and if I can just ask if they can bring up the names, we'll introduce them. Nigel Clark, David Malpass, Odile Renaud-Bassot, Sir Danny Alexander, and moderated by Azucena Arbecele.
Good afternoon, everybody. Many thanks, Secretary Yelling, for your words. I think your comment about being the first US Treasurer attending a COP speaks for the historic times that we are facing today. I am Azucena Arbelete, Minister of Finance of Uruguay, and I am delighted to chair this panel on structural shifts needed to mobilize more private finance. We are facing a global climate emergency that demands immediate action and long-term solutions. There is no room for small fixes and incremental solutions. The truth is we need transformative change. Emerging markets and developed countries, we will need $1 trillion in additional investment annually for decades to build green energy and climate resilient infrastructure. Yet, As we seek sustainable pathways, our public sector balance sheets will be constrained in this post-COVID-19 world. I am fortunate today to have a fairly unique perspective on these trade-offs, since I'm wearing two hats at the same time. I'm not only Minister of Finance in Uruguay, but at the same time, I'm chairing the Development Committee of the World Bank and IMF. Given the scale of the task at hand, I think it's essential that we need to talk, to walk the talk. What we need to do is to walk the talk. Announcements and commitments without action and accountability are more a mere words. This means at least two things. First, developed countries should strive to fulfill their commitment on deploying the pledged resources, including grants, to developing countries to support them in meeting their climate goals. Second, recipient countries, we need to show that we really mean it when we say that we care about climate change. For this, we need credible action. So I intend to use my role as Development Committee Chair to underscore these points and to put forward practical proposals for how this can be achieved by using the power of financial incentives and financial innovation to reward sustainable policymaking. To do this, we need to link the cost of borrowing of countries with their success in meeting climate targets under the Paris Agreement. In particular, countries that live up to their commitments and show good environmental performance should pay lower interest rates, freeing up money to achieve ambitious goals. To develop this idea, the government of Uruguay is pioneering work on designing a sovereign sustainability-linked bond that will explicitly incorporate forward-looking environmental commitments based on our nationally determined contributions under the Paris Agreement. At the same time, as part of the agenda of the Development Committee, I will put forward the mainstreaming of NDCs into multilateral loans and to differentiate lending conditions based on countries' contribution to global public goods and Paris alignment. Commitment needs to be demonstrated, and environmental integrity needs to be rewarded. So, after this introduction, let me introduce my panelists. We have heard some fascinating perspectives and new initiatives on mobilizing the capital needed in the first half of this event, predominantly from donor countries and private sector organizations. So now is the opportunity to hear from recipient countries and the multilateral development banks on the structural shifts needed across both public and multilateral institutions. So without further ado, it gives me enormous pleasure to welcome our distinguished panel. So starting from the left, Mr. Danny Alexander, Vice President of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, then my colleague, Minister of Finance of Jamaica, Mr. Nigel Clark. From the right, President David Malpass from the World Bank, And next to me is sitting Mrs. Odile Renaud-Bassot, President of the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development. I apologize for my bad French pronunciation and bad English pronunciation as well. So let's begin, Minister, asking you, what is your vision for mobilized climate finance in Jamaica and your wider region, and what support do you need from MDBs and other actors to deliver this?
Thank you, Madam Chair. So our approach to climate financing, we can describe in two buckets. The first is disaster risk financing, where we seek to accumulate ex ante and a priori the resources that can be made available in the event of natural disaster. And the second would include the financing for adaptation activities. Jamaica is among the countries in the world who are, or which are at the front line, on the front line of this exposure. Natural disaster is a regular occurrence, costing 2% of GDP on an annual basis, with the ever certain risk that every several years that amount can be as high as 8 or 9% of GDP, and then every generation, the experience has shown, hits that cost far more, 30 and 40% of GDP. We're taking responsibility for that vulnerability with the help of our international partners and multilateral institutions in providing ex ante a framework of financing that can be available in the event of such disasters. Jamaica would have this year become the first independent island state in the world to independently sponsor a catastrophe bond with the technical support of the World Bank and with the assistance of our bilateral partners. I mention this to bring into the discussion the role for innovative and creative financing, in this case, catastrophe bonds that cover hurricane risk involve the provision of exposure to the investing world of uncorrelated risk, risk that's uncorrelated with equity and other markets. And the experience shows in the context of a preparation of this investing opportunity that leveraged the World Bank's balance sheet that there were several institutions in the space of private institutions, in the space of insurance and reinsurance, and other fund managers who were eager to participate in this inaugural issue by Jamaica. And it just demonstrates that with innovation and creativity, we can bring capital to this space. Adaptation or funding for adaptation, the governments of our region, the fiscal space does not exist to finance the adaptation required from the public purse. And as a result, we're going to have to find ways of exciting and interesting private capital to help to finance some of these activities. Again, the approach that we are using is to leverage our achievements in the public-private partnership arena, where we have spent policy and regulatory capital to create an environment that is attractive to international investors. And again, working with the IFC, a subsidiary of the World Bank, we believe the capacity exists to bring a lot of capital to help with some of the adaptation measures that are going to be required. But the key message is innovation and creation and creativity as far as disaster risk financing is concerned, and leveraging PPP structures through multilateral institutions to bring capital that can assist in adaptation. And in that latter regard, where we can scale up, I believe, is in project preparation and structuring. A lot of what prevents international capital from accessing these opportunities is lack of structuring in a way that private international capital can find attractive and motivating. And I think a lot of effort and attention needs to be spent on structuring and in preparing projects.
Thank you, Minister. Let's now turn to the multilaterals to see what we can hear from them today. So, Mr. Malpass, based on what we have already heard from the Minister and from the conversations that we've had these days, how can multilateral development banks and the private sector improve coordination to scale private climate mobilization? And specifically, what is the World Bank Group doing to develop mobilization platforms and vehicles to meet the need of investors?
Thanks. Thanks very much, Azucena. So I'll start with the Sri Mulyani challenge, which we heard, which is what are the conditions sufficient for Indonesia to attract the amounts of money that that are needed? And she described the $270 billion that's needed, not very much compared to the $130 trillion that Mark committed earlier today, but still a lot, $270 billion. To put that in perspective, the World Bank is the biggest multilateral financer, and so we did $157 billion last year in all of the year. So Indonesia is talking about two full years of all the output of the World Bank, and it's actually more than that because the $157 billion was 15 months. So it's really 3 years of World Bank output. She said 21% could come from the budget, 50% would have to come from a gap that could be filled. So I wanted to describe that because we have to discuss global public goods here. There is some discussion of bankable projects, but the number of bankable projects in this space is a small percentage of the overall effort that's needed in the climate change action space. The big majority is going to be negative cash flow through the life of the project. So that means we need a lot more projects in order to actually make an impact. But there has to be huge flows of funds that are planning to lose all of the money. And so as people talk about blended finance, we have to bring that into the much bigger picture of the amount. And that brings to the grant resources. So as the private sector looks at this, there needs to be channeling mechanisms for huge amounts of private sector money that won't be returned. And so I just want to get that started. We heard from Azucena the importance of differentiation for countries based on NDCs. So for example, if the goal is to have a very low interest rate for countries with good NDCs, that means funding the losses to the investor. Because we heard earlier today, we heard just now from PKA that investors and savers want to get a very good pension. So the challenge that we're facing is the need for total return, risk-weighted returns by investors and asset managers at a time when the fragile countries, as we know from working in fragility states, there are huge risks that are not absorbed in the market. That shows you why the investment flow into emerging markets in general is small now, and it's small in climate finance. As you know, the World Bank is the biggest financial institution in climate finance, but it's small compared to the needs that Indonesia described to us. So I'll just make a couple of other points. One is the importance of the incentive structure in countries and the enabling environment that they described. So Jamaica just described very well that. And World Bank can work with that on a country-by-country basis in order to create platforms that bring in private sector capital for things like disaster relief. We're working with South Africa, but to give you some of the numbers on South Africa, There needs to be $250 million maybe to decommission 1 gigawatt per gigawatt. There needs to be $350 million to repurpose the waste and the asbestos for it. There needs to be solar panels that bring in some private sector investment, so a small portion of the overall project is bankable with new energy. And then there needs to be a huge stream of money over decades that will pay for the social impact. So as we think about the challenges here, we're integrating climate and development in a number of countries that don't have electricity access. We heard earlier 800 million people without even access to electricity. So there needs to be the big expansion of energy output in a clean way that then is financed by very large losses from the private sector as it channels funds into this space. So that's the challenge that we're working with as we put together platforms that can pool these resources and then apply them to meaningful projects, impactful projects, such as decommissioning coal.
Thank you, Mr. Malpass. So we have a similar question to the President of European Bank of Reconstruction and Development. So Mrs. Renaud-Basso, we heard from the investors in the first panel the lack of what we would say are investable projects. So, and the constraint that this means to mobilizing private climate finance at scale. What, from your perspective, is the European Bank doing to deliver a step change in the pipeline of bankable projects, and how can MDBs shift in incentives to place a greater focus on mobilization in general?
Thank you very much for your question, and indeed it's a fascinating debate. EBRD has been created in the 90s at the time of the collapse of the Soviet Union, with the focus to be private focused, with a private mandate. So to bring together a private players to finance the private sector to deliver on public goods. So in a way, at the core of our DNA, we are at the bit of the junction between public goods, common objective, and private sector financing. Now we are facing, different challenge, which is a bit of the same nature. And I think that our role as MDB is multifaceted. The first one, the core of our activity, is to finance ourselves project to support climate. We are much smaller than World Bank, but we are working on countries for which climate is a huge, issue, and which are high emitters, very energy intensive for most of them. So this is a big challenge, and with our own financing, our lending activity, we do our best efforts to help them in the decarbonization. So we have ourselves a target to have 50% of our financing in the green sector by 2025. We are almost at 40 already or more, and to be fully Paris aligned in all our activity by the end of 2022. And with this kind of financial support, I think that we play in a way what was in the previous roundtable characterized by Marc Carnet as a role of first money. So we try to find projects on which we have innovative partner with new project, new ideas, new concept, first issuance of green bond for an emerging country, first auctioning mechanism for renewable in Egypt. And so with this kind of approach, we open the way and then help hoping and hopefully quite successfully, to open up the ground for the private sectors to step in, having seen that this is feasible, that there is a demand, that the market is marketable. But, alone, I think that we are fully aware, and as the discussion showed, that we really need to bring, at higher scale, the private sector. And so that's why we are developing an action plan. We have just, I'm happy to announce today an action plan on mobilization of the private sector, which should allow us to double our private sector mobilization. And with the key objective is really to foster the systemic shift to a low carbon resilient economies and to have much more bankable, commercially viable project. There is not one single solution to do that. I think that there are a number of actions we need to do. I was talking about our own financing, but there are many other things. We have defined 12 actions that would help. Financing of green and sustainability bonds, renewable action, country platform mobilization. So there were a lot of discussion in the previous roundtable about country platform. I think country platform with all MDBs plus private sector to exchange on the pipeline of project, I mean, discuss what can be in the project themselves and the financing of them. I think that could be very efficient. But also the policy activity. As an MDB, we are not only doing financing, but we also provide advice to the countries, helping them to define NDCs, long-term strategies, sectoral strategies, in coordination with other MDBs. And I think that the collective action in that dimension would be very important in order to avoid everybody, I mean, multiplication and possible contradiction. And this is very important. This policy activity is very important because it's very clear that to have more bankable projects, to have more private financing possible, you need to have a very clear regulatory framework with very clear long-term objective about when net zero should be reached, what is the pathway towards net zero, so as to allow investors to make choice in a clear and readable environment. And if there is only, you know, a very long-term net zero target but no strategy to go there, it's very difficult for investors to decide what is the right decision, where should I invest. So I think this is a very important work we can help the countries with. And in that respect, I must say that I strongly believe that carbon price, which I know is of very high interest for finance ministers, would be a very important step also to give the right financial incentive, because up to now, unfortunately, I think that there is no better mechanism than the market to ensure a good allocation of resources and have for the best cost-efficient mechanism for in the best price cost mechanism allocation. So I think this is what we are committed to do in order to contribute to net decarbonization in the countries in which we intervene, and bringing in much more private capital, because I really believe that with the announcement made today about 130 trillion of capital available for the green transition, what is key is to ensure that emerging and developing countries have a fair share of it and receive really the money needed and the investment needed in order to support the transition. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we turn now to our last panelist, Mr. Alexander from the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So scaling sovereign and corporate issuances of green bonds will be key to mobilizing more climate finance into emerging markets and developing economies. What's the Asian Investment and Infrastructure Bank, Infrastructure and Investment Bank's vision for supporting partner countries tap into green capital markets at much greater scale? And maybe more broadly, how do we integrate climate risk into the investment decision-making process for multilaterals, but also for the private sector?
Thank you very much indeed. And it's a pleasure to follow the World Bank and the EBRD, two institutions that have been making a huge impact in this space for a long time. As a relatively new institution, the AIB is also very committed to increasing the climate finance. Our president, Jin Lee Chun, announced that we would target 50% of our financing to be climate financed by 2025 and estimate that we will commit $50 billion to climate finance by 2030. We also aim that by 2030, half of our financing will be aimed at the private sector. And so the point that you make about the importance of mobilizing climate finance from the capital markets is very important and something that we have been working on, because the capital markets are essential in mobilizing private capital to the trillions of dollars that are needed. Additional green and climate capital could be unlocked if some of the barriers could be lifted. Notably, the awareness of climate and green assets and their identification, clear standards, and innovative product development. So AIB has launched our Sustainable Capital Markets Initiative, where we use our investments in the capital market as a proof of concept that investing with an ESG strategy can generate positive returns. Over time, we hope to create new benchmarks for infrastructure investment to provide research to ensure that investors have the information that they need to make the right investment choices. And we're working with research partners to share insights on emerging issues and ESG trends. But crucially, it's about transparency and disclosure. ESG ratings are only as good as the disclosures made by the issuer. Therefore, a key component of this initiative is working with stakeholders to promote better transparency and disclosure in the capital markets. Deepening the debt capital markets in Asia and emerging markets and improving the understanding of ESG will require ongoing capacity building of all market participants. We're seeking to do that through the climate change investment framework that we have put forward in partnership with Amundi and the Climate Bond Initiative to set a clear definition and approach for Paris alignment in the capital markets, focusing not on the proceeds of green bonds only, but looking at the issuer as a whole so that investors have information about issuers who are living up to the Paris alignment standards that need to be met. So the Asia Climate Bond Portfolio has been established to give proof of this concept with an initial investment of $500 million US dollars, and the experience and data gained will be shared with the market. Your second point about the importance of adaptation and resilience and risk assessment is critically important, and especially in Asia, which will suffer disproportionately from the impacts of climate change. Climate risks need to be acknowledged, defined, and quantified, and then integrated into investment decision-making, both at the project level and at the system level. At the project level, we screen all of our projects for their climate risk exposure and integrated that into the project cycle. The system level, we want to make sure that investors and sponsors are able to realize climate risks and to create systems which enable those risks to be proven and to develop a methodology that can clearly demonstrate climate risks and the costs and benefits of financing, to allow the private sector to more correctly price climate risk and therefore develop financing structures that mobilize private capital into adaptation and resilience. To that end, we're working with the Coalition for Climate Resilient Investment to find an approach to transform infrastructure investment by integrating climate risks into investment decision making. They've developed a very good methodology and have a good network. We hope we can bring some of our finance to help prove that that can work and develop that concept more fully. So I think these are examples of ways that we can work in partnership. And I want to finish by saying that to achieve these goals and to mobilize the $130 trillion that has been discussed today will involve partnership working, not only among MDBs working together, but MDBs and the private sector, other development partners, all working together to innovate and to identify the best means to unlock this capital. AIB is very committed to playing its full part in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Alexander, and thank you all the panelists for these thought-provoking insights. We have heard a range of perspectives. We have covered some examples of what has worked well to date, but most importantly, I would say what is needed if we are truly to step up into this challenge and get full finance requirements met in emerging markets and developing countries. For example, we heard from my colleague, Minister Clark, a compelling vision for the role climate finance can play in green growth, creating jobs and reducing poverty in parallel, provided that the necessary technical support and funding is in place. Then we heard from the MDB colleagues on the actions they have put in place to date and how they intend to step up over the coming months and years. Mr. Malpas talked us through the intention of the bank to develop innovative investment platforms to crowd in new type of investors into emerging markets and developing economies. Mrs. Renaud Bassot highlighted both internal and external challenges to mobilizing finances, commented on the importance of this new money or new issuance of the presence of the bank in that regard, and commented on there's no single solution, no size fits all in this topic. Finally, Vice President Alexander drew attention to the importance of local capital markets and the role that multilateral development banks can play, both in terms of providing expertise and absorbing risk, And I think you said that it's important to look investor as a whole, or, and the issuer, I would add, as a whole. It's important to see the whole areas that the issuer has and the whole areas that the investor has, and not only one perspective. I think that a common thread that run through all this reflection is the importance of collaboration, as was said and focused by Alexandra at the end. And we heard some very interesting examples of this collaboration, but clearly more is needed if we want to meet our collective goals. In the first panel this afternoon, we heard from the private sector that there is capital ready to flow. Developing countries and emerging markets now need support in accessing this. Multilateral development banks have traditionally focused on lending and are already taking action to deliver against a range of priorities, including the mobilization of finance. But in terms of future collaboration, it will be vital to establish exactly how the multilateral system can mobilize finance that is substantially more private. I look forward very much to accelerating this collaboration and furthering this crucial roadmap as part of the agenda in the Development Committee. So thank you again to all the panelists. And now I will hand over the floor to my colleague, the Minister of Finance of Egypt. I just wanted to be sure he's in the room. No, so